Thank you.
I'm Tom. We've covered that bit. I'm exhausting when I'm not exhausted. And I've been described as having the experience and temperament of a 70-year-old inside the body of a child, which I think the lady at M&S when I was getting the train home last night, who ID'd me for a can of beer, probably would agree with, actually. That's a, yeah, privilege. Probably a better way to describe me is as a creative entrepreneur. I've tried a lot of different ways of describing what it is that I do, and that pretty much encompasses, you know, the creative and the entrepreneur bit, I suppose, without sounding too wanky. It's sort of minimal wank, I suppose. I've also started teaching at Hallam, which is a really nice extra thing to be doing. You can read. Yeah, it's probably a better way of describing me, if I'm honest. I tend to be a person who connects things to other things, a bit like Penny here, and sort of tweaks things to bring them to life. And the three things that I really, really like to do are convening people around making, eating, and learning. And I've done that in various guises over the last decade or so. I've run supper clubs and done a bit of chefing here and there. I do some making and convene people around making, more importantly, at Makerversity. So I'm just going to play a quick film that shows you a little bit about Makerversity for those of you that don't know. I'm not going to talk too much about Makerversity this morning because, well, that video does it better than I would anyway. But if anybody wants to ask anything about that afterwards, please come and ask me. So that's making. And then the third thing is learning. Again, just a really quick video to talk about how we've done some of the learning stuff that we do at Makerversity.
At Makerversity, our members that we have here make up the faculty. They're the ones that we develop the lessons with. Over the last 12 months, we've been working with different member businesses to come up with different ideas for lessons that will take skills that they use in a day-to-day basis as designers and engineers and take them directly into schools and teach them to young people.
So yeah, that's just a real snapshot. But yeah, the reason why those three things are interesting to me is because they are pretty much the three most leveling pursuits you can do. They're a kind of common denominator for most people. And they're really the three things that most people would like to do more of. And so the idea of finding ways to convene people around doing more of the things that they actually want to do more of, and the lovely tangential benefits that can bring to people is why those three things are the things that I tend to focus on. So the theme of Creative Mornings this morning is mystery. I sort of was just like, what on earth am I going to do with that? It doesn't really, I'm not really a particularly mysterious person. I tend to wear my heart on my sleeve a bit. And so I didn't really know what to do with it. And I thought the best thing to do really was to, rather than bang on about the things that I've done or whatever, was to just talk about a bunch of things that I was finding interesting at the moment, and then try and sort of retrofit them with a mysterious twist.
You are not you. You're me. No shit.
So I thought I'd start with three things that you may well not have seen that have come out of Makerversity recently. They're nothing to do with us as an organisation. They're just brilliant people that are based where we are. So up until now, they will have been a mystery to you, possibly. So the first one is a startup called Gravity Light, and they have, as you can see here, have invented a light that is powered entirely by gravity. So there's this sort of sandbag thing there that drops over time, and the kinetic energy then powers a light, which is taking off all over the world, as you can probably imagine. It's a pretty amazing project. and one that I'm very excited to see where it goes to. The second thing is called, this is a bento lab. It's by an organization called Bento Bio. And what they've essentially done is they've taken the principle of a Raspberry Pi, which is, for those of you that don't know, like a small, very, very cheap computer that basically anyone can use and program. And they've applied the same principles to a biology lab. So this is a desktop biology lab, about the size of a lunchbox, hence the name Bento, with a centrifuge and lots of other things that I don't know the names of. And essentially it allows people, both in education, but also working for people out in the field, if you work for an NGO, to conduct pretty high level biology experiments in the field or in the classroom. These things cost less than 100 quid. And they allow you to extract DNA with the centrifuge, test all sorts of things. They do amazing demos with this to test burgers for horse meat and things like that. It's incredible what you can do with it. And I just think this is a great example of something that that is really democratizing access to what has always been really, really sort of high-level kit that you could only find in wet rooms and labs. And that's a real founding principle of Makerversity, is this idea that that everybody deserves access to these things. And then the third thing, which is interesting and topical with the pollution at the moment in London and various other bits of the country, Tree Wi-Fi. So this is actually a guy based out of Makerversity Amsterdam. And he has created a bird box that monitors air pollution levels. And as air pollution levels drop, free Wi-Fi increases. So the more you do as a community to cut your air pollution, the faster the broadband you get is, which I just think is an absolutely brilliant idea, which is they're rolling it out all over Amsterdam at the moment, and I hope it's going to spread further than that. Because this idea, again, of sort of convening people around a common cause that is as sort of carrot as it is stick, if you like, in the way that it goes about things is really important. So keep your eyes on those three things. I think they're all going to be doing big things. Next bit, seven things. Why seven? Because that's how many I had time to think of. That it's useful to demystify if you're a creative. This is heavily retrofitted with the mystery theme. It's just seven things that I've been thinking about a bit. First one is trust. So trust is a very interesting thing in the kind of in the creative industries. It's something that everybody who works within the creative industries has to build up to some degree with a client or a user base or whatever it is. And there are two, sorry, do you want to, please? And there are two types of trust, and I think understanding the difference between the two types of trust is a really useful thing when you're trying to set out to gain it from somebody, I suppose. That sounds kind of transactional, but it is really important. So the first is trust based on reliability. And that kind of trust is the kind of trust that we're used to seeing from things like public services, from transport systems, from mobile phone networks. It's the kind of trust that you build up with something when it works, right? And the second type of trust is based on belonging. And belonging is something that you feel and a trust that you feel with your family, with your favorite football team or with the community. And that kind of trust is interesting because you might think that your brother or your mother or whoever is largely an unreliable moron, but you will still trust them implicitly because that is just what you do when you belong to something. And the interesting thing about that is that reliable trust, the kind of trust that we're talking about with public services, with transport, with traditional large corporations, is very, very brittle. So if I went to go and get a train now from the station and it was 3 minutes late, I'd be really annoyed about it. If my phone signal drops out for 5 seconds, it does my head in. But if you think about what's actually the mechanisms that are happening to allow you to do that thing, a mobile phone, if I wanted to message one of you now and it took a minute to come through, there'd be signals going to space and back through the ether. And the fact that you could possibly get frustrated with that is crazy when you rationally think about it. But that is the basis for most sort of consumer-producer relationships that have existed, particularly in the 20th century. Now, belonging is a very different thing, and this is something which all sorts of companies, particularly tech companies, have started to unlock over the last 10 years. And it's much, much more elastic. So you are able to have a lot more leeway with things. You can be a lot more unreliable and still hold people's trust. And that's something which is very powerful and also very dangerous, I guess. But the powerful bit is the bit that, I think is interesting. And generally, I think that spot there is, kind of the sweet spot when you're thinking about trust. When you're trying to build trust in people, you want to make sure that people feel like they can belong to something. This is something that's been very, very important to Makerversity. We probably started a lot further over to the left. We sort of had lots of people interested in what we were doing, but we're incredibly unreliable to start with. And I think we've kind of deliberately stopped on our journey towards reliability as an organisation, because as soon as you become too reliable, people start hating you if something doesn't work immediately. And so striking that balance, particularly when, you know, we're running an organisation that essentially provides services to people who are very busy and often skint, you know, you think that you want to be as reliable as possible, but actually the relationship that engenders is not always a positive one. So hopefully that's demystified trust. Some of you have seen this already, but I thought I'd show it again just because I think it's really, really useful. So leadership, mystery number two. We are told all the time that we need to be leaders and that everyone should be a leader. And that's kind of a misnomer, really. I think leadership is really much more about following. And rather than try and tell you why, I'm going to show you another video.
If you've learned a lot about leadership and making a movement, then let's watch a movement happen start to finish in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons. First, of course, a leader needs the guts to stand alone and look ridiculous. But what he's doing is so simple, it's almost instructional. This is key. You must be easy to follow. Now here comes the first follower with a crucial role. He publicly shows everyone else how to follow. Notice how the leader embraces him as an equal. So it's not about the leader anymore, it's about them, plural. Notice how he's calling to his friends to join in. See, it takes guts to be a first follower. You stand out and you brave ridicule yourself. Being a first follower is an underappreciated form of leadership. The first follower transforms a lone nut into a leader. If the leader is the flint, the first follower is the spark that really makes the fire. Now here's the second follower. This is a turning point. It's proof the first has done well. Now it's not a lone nut, and it's not two nuts. Three is a crowd, and a crowd is news. A movement must be public. Make sure outsiders see more than just the leader. Everyone needs to see the followers, because new followers emulate followers, not the leader. Now here come two more people, then three more immediately. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point, and now we have a movement. As more people jump in, it's no longer risky. If they were on the fence before, there's no reason not to join in now. They won't stand out, they won't be ridiculed, and they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. And over the next minute, you'll see the rest who prefer to stay part of the crowd, because eventually they'd be ridiculed for not joining. And ladies and gentlemen, that is how a movement is made. So let's recap what we've learned. If you are a version of the shirtless dancing guy, all alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals, making everything clearly about the movement, not you. Be public, be easy to follow. But the biggest lesson here, did you catch it? Leadership is over-glorified. Yes, it started with the shirtless guy, and he'll get all the credit, but you saw what really happened. It was the first follower that transformed a lone nut into a leader. There's no movement without the first follower. See, we're told that we all need to be leaders, but that would be really ineffective. The best way to make a movement, if you really care, is to courageously follow and show others how to follow. When you find a lone nut doing something great, have the guts to be the first person to stand up and join in.
There you go. I'll come on to that in a sec. So I showed that video last night at another talk, and somebody yelled out, "Sounds like Donald Trump." And I was like, "Oh shit, that's not really quite what I was going for in terms of how to build a movement." But fair enough. Anyway, I'm sure you're all distracted by this beautiful GIF here on the left. So the third mystery is about passion, and passion again is something that we hear a lot about in the creative industries. People always like to tell you how passionate they are about what they're doing and how, you know, what they're doing was a passion project and it's become this thing and that, this, that and the other. I met a guy who I'll talk about very briefly later on, a few years ago, who was a sort of social enterprise guru dude, I suppose. And he had a real objection to the word passion. He said passion is the abandonment of reason, and that people commit crimes of passion. You know, you have an affair if you're feeling passionate. You generally make bad decisions when you're passionate about something. And that's always stuck with me when he said that, because this sense that we have to give our all and everything and be completely focused and passionate about this thing that we're doing, and the fact that we use that word a lot is really interesting and not always particularly healthy. So he said, this guy John said, you know, it's the worst possible trait you can see in an entrepreneur, and that blew my mind at the time and made me think a lot. And he said, you know, you need to be able to embrace uncertainty, but you've got to be positive about that as well. But this sense that you need to actually, if you want to get somewhere, just step back a little bit from the kind of the front line of feeling, really feeling those feelings, is a really interesting concept. I mean, I think I would, in some ways, challenge it, but he's more eloquent than me, so I won't. Mystery number four, epiphany. Similar sort of thing, really. It's a phrase that we hear a lot. People talking about how they started their business, what their idea was. They have this moment, this spark, where they can see, you know, they can see the finish line, this thing that they've created that's going to solve a huge world ill. But the problem with epiphanies is they make you really inflexible. So if you have a bright idea, a brilliant idea for something that's going to solve something, the chances are that you're not going to be flexible enough to change that idea if it needs to be changed to still reach the goal that you're trying to achieve. And it's much better to think about tackling a big problem by having your eyes on what that goal is and being willing to do anything moral, legal, ethical to get there. And it's much more a process of behaving like medical testers than somebody who's passionate or has their big light bulb moment. So this idea that, you know, a medical tester will want to cure cancer and will do anything they can. They will sample every plant in the rainforest. They'll do whatever they need to try and find the answer. They're not wedded to this great idea that they've had. That's, I don't know, kind of an interesting thing as well, just in terms of language that's very common around this sort of the creative industries and trying to sort of unpick it a little bit. Mystery number five is impact. Again, another word that we use a lot. We all talk about impact businesses. We talk about the kind of impact we want to have. This gift will make more sense in a minute. so you're probably wondering what on earth is going on. But the problem with impact is that it can, particularly in the first 10 years of any organisation or new thing, it can very, very rarely ever be measured properly. There are just too many variables when it comes to thinking about impact. So human life is complex and ecosystems are complex. And you can't definitively say whether or not the thing that you have done necessarily created the results that you're seeing. This guy John again, who I really need to thank a lot because he's basically made up my entire talk, said something to me as well, which kind of blew my mind again, because I met this guy at this kind of the start of the Makerversity journey, if you like, and lots of people, we were talking about what we wanted to achieve, our social mission, blah blah blah, and people were saying, oh, you know, what kind of impact are you going to have? We'll fund you if you do this, that, and the other. And he said, Don't listen to that. What you need to do if you really want to understand what you're doing over a long period of time is to look at the shadows and work out what is casting them, what's creating those shadows. So it's a process of inference rather than definition. I told you the GIF would make more sense now. Oh, bless him. And so the thing I'd say about it is try not to work with people who are asking you to define and measure your impact. It's very, very difficult to demonstrate impact. And what ends up happening if you start on that journey is that you either get yourself in a position where you have to lie and say you do know that you've made that impact, or you have to disappoint them and say we don't know. And neither of those scenarios are particularly useful for anybody. It's much, much better to have that conversation up front. Mystery number six, language. Language is an interesting beast. This is a picture that we took in Louisiana outside an adult store. Semis mean something different in America. The important point about it is, like, what makes sense to you might not make sense to somebody else. And again, if you're thinking about trying to get an idea across to people, then you really want to use language that people are going to be able to get on board with. And it's very, very easy to disappear down your own rabbit hole with this as well. You know, you suddenly find yourself using words that become everyday to you that mean absolutely nothing to anyone else. And they can be really, really sort of technical, or they can be much more just sort of bullshit bingo. And these are things that just just drop into people's lives without them even realizing. And it's really, really worth making sure that you think about that and the impression that it's giving to the people that you're trying to work with. And that sums it up, really, I think. If you want your idea to be understood, and most people do, just keep it simple. Keep it really, really simple. Because coming back to the thing that I said at the start around making, eating, and learning, you know, there are common denominators in our fairly divided and mixed up society. And those common denominators are really, really valuable. And one of those is plain English, basically, just saying things as they are. And a lot of distrust is built around the fact that people tend to try and over-intellectualize things. They tend to try and make themselves, for whatever reason, sound and feel more intellectual than they actually are. And that just ends up alienating people. Good writer image. That's where I was meant to put a slide in for a good writer. mystery number seven. Thinking. This is a really interesting one as well. That I've just started delving into this. Have you ever seen anyone think so hard? Thinking is something that I've only just really found out in the last couple of days, to be honest. You can break down into fast and slow. And this is a really useful thing that I've started again to think about in terms of my practice and the way that I work and the way that I engage with people, what I ask other people to do. There's two systems of thinking. One is fast, one is slow. And it's much easier if I leave it to a Nobel Prize winning person, Daniel Kahneman, to tell you what that means.
Many psychologists think of the mind in terms of two systems. System one is the associative one. System one is the impulsive one. System one tends to be more emotional. System two is capable of following rules. And system two is more socialized in the sense that it supervises what people say and to some extent what they think, and tends to bring those things in line with existing norms.
Now, I think what's interesting about that for me is that, and the thing that I took away from it was that what you really want to do in life in general, I guess, is to push system one, i.e. the fast thinking thing, as far as you can, while being aware of system two. So, If you want to, this comes back to a lot of the things that I was saying about passion and epiphanies. Thinking fast and doing things fast is fantastic, but make sure that when you're doing that, it's embedded in a sense of, okay, where are the social norms around this? You don't have to stick to them, but it's important to reference them and know where they are, so that whatever you're doing, whatever this thing is that you're thinking fast about, other people can get on board with it and can understand it. So that's the seven things. So now we've got my top three mystery shatterers. There's a phrase for you. This is three people who I like, and they didn't know they were mystery shatterers until this subject for Creative Mornings came up, but now they are. The first one is John Gargani. He's the guy that I was just talking about and referencing through for most of that material. He is a social enterprise guy based at Stanford. He's an absolutely fascinating guy. There's lots of videos and journals that he's written online. I couldn't recommend anyone more to spend your time reading about and looking up. What he can't tell you about how to start a business, how to be a creative entrepreneur, isn't worth knowing. He's got his six rules of business failure that are just phenomenal to read, because you'll read down the list and be like, I fail every single one of them and I need to do something about it. Very, very interesting guy. The second one is the guy who we just saw speak. There's, again, a lot of material, Nobel Prize winner. The more I dig in, I'm just at the start of this, really, like chipping away at what he's all about. The more I dig into this idea of how we think, and if you can understand a bit and put some rules around how people think, then it becomes a very useful tool. The more I dig in, the more interesting it becomes. So I would highly recommend exploring him. And then the third one, again, some of you will probably heard me talk about Danella Meadows before. She's a systems thinker. She's also a farmer. And she really, really helps and has helped me a lot to understand the systems that we live in society on a really sort of macro level and on a real micro level as well. So she's written a book and a paper called Leverage Points, which is all about where the moments are in a system, the leverage points where you can best interact with that system and have influence over it. So understanding where those points are, touch points, leverage points, whatever you want to call them, is a really, really useful device when you're trying to look at something complex and work out where you can have impact on that. So those are the three mystery shatterers. And then I thought I'd just really quickly talk about what I want to do next. I've got a project that I'm sort of kicking around in my head, and really I wanted to put it out there just to, first of all, see what people thought, but also see if people can help me to do it. So I want to try and spend a day doing each of the 100 skills that have been determined as the things that we need for a thriving local economy and society. There's all sorts of things in there. A guy called Rob Hopkins, who's involved in the transition movement, came up with it. And there's all sorts of things from learning to forge, to being a rope maker, to churning butter, to all these things. And I'm kind of fascinated by the idea that I could try every single one of them and document them somehow. It's a long project, I think. 100 days doing that would take a while, but I do think it's interesting. So if any of you guys are secret rope makers or dry stone wallers, or you've got a cow that needs milking, then let me know afterwards, because I'm really, really seriously trying to put something together around it, and I think it would be an interesting experience. And I thought I'd just finish with a film that best represents exactly what I want to be. I mean, this guy, he's showing grit and determination. He needs to get his barge somewhere, and he's only got a digger to do so. He's got his first follower there in a red hat, so he's a leader, he's embracing his follower. And nothing's going to stop him getting to where he wants to be, but he's been pretty pragmatic about it. So I'll leave you with that. That's me. Thank you.